Tell me a bit about Tom.
Okay. So Tom was born in Coventry. He was actually born in Gulston Hospital, which meant then he was born within the city walls at the time. So he was always quite proud of that, you know, sort of thing, because I wasn't. I was born at home, so I was outside of the city centre. So he was won over, sort of thing, really, that he could say he was a true Coventrian. I think one of the other things that's on the bench, really, is the sort of like the four little bits in the corner, which is sort of part of him so much, really, in that he loved music. Like, he enjoyed reading and going to the theatre. He saw some wonderful performances. So to go to the theatre was the things that he liked. He also liked the rugby. There was only one team that he wasn't over keen on, but he would always enjoy watching England and Scotland and Ireland play. And he just, the other part of it is just a tree of life, really. And he just enjoyed life itself. He enjoyed the nature part of it, you know. But life itself, travelling and just meeting people, it was very difficult to get away often if he started chatting to people, because he liked engaging in conversation, finding out about people. You know, he would be able to get people to speak that were normally sort of quite reticent. It was one of the things that he was able to do, and I enjoyed watching him and thinking, well, how long are we going to be now, I wonder, waiting to see what would be happening. I don't know, really. It's just lots of things that you think about that make him come back to me, sort of thing, in different pieces of music, because he did enjoy the music. We went travelling for some times, and we both enjoyed that aspect of things. And it is one of the things that I've tried to do a little bit since it's been gone, but it's not quite the same. It's difficult travelling when you haven't got anybody at the end of the day to say, you know, well, that was good, or that was a waste of the day then. It's those things that you miss, really, I think. I think I was lucky to have met him and lucky to have time with him.
Tell me how you met.
Okie doke. Well, we both lived sort of not very far away from each other. And in actual fact, we met in town in a pub, which wasn't an unusual event at that time.
Just a random bumping into.
Yeah. We'd known each other by sight, sort of thing, and ended up going from the pub to a party, and stayed then, sort of thing. Just carried on, really.
And how old were you then?
Nearly 20.
So what was it about him then that attracted you?
Long eyelashes.
Ooh. Okay.
Long eyelashes. And he had a flipping, like a double layer as well. So those probably, the eyes, definitely. Yeah, definitely. And then chatting, sense of humour, same sort of things that we liked, really. And just music more than anything else.
So that's the second time you mentioned music. So what music did he like?
He was very fond of the Rolling Stones. He'd been to see David Bowie and T-Rex way before, sort of thing. They were popular. They were the sort of things that he followed as well. Not so much sort of the Beatles like I'd done. He was more into the Rolling Stones and those different sorts of music. He was able to see the Rolling Stones a couple of times, including in Twickenham, which was somewhere that he really enjoyed. Kids had got tickets for that. He must have gone three or four times to see the Stones. And I think one of the greatest things that he really enjoyed was the fact that we've seen Nina Simone and seen her live, and it wasn't too long before she passed away, really.
Yeah. Was it amazing?
It was absolutely incredible, yeah.
You followed Tom's eyelashes
into
a happily ever after.
Yes.
That's all right. And you had two children.
Yes, yeah, two boys.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think one of my sort of memories of him is watching him. Both of the boys had passed the driving test in the car and needed to go for an MOT, and it'd come back and needed something. And they got the Haynes manual out and were doing it. And I could see he was desperate to go and check it before and see that they were doing it how he thought it should be done. But he was able to stand back and watch and agree, you know, that they'd done it and go back over it, sort of thing. But I think they had that experience from him that, you know, it can be done. And if it can be done, then I can probably do it as well.
So the position of the bench is to do with where he would go running and the train. Is there any other reason for that position?
I think it's quite interesting because where it is, it's where he would like to be, because there's so much of a good vista there. You can watch people, you know, sort of thing, that are going into the cafe. You can look down and see the kids playing. When the music was on, because we used to like to go over to the Godiva Festival, mm-hmm. I think from there he would be able to have a good listen as well, so he won't be missing out on much.
You don't think that he would be too fussed about this?
Mm.
What's made you want to take part?
And I think it was because I was quite interested, and I'd spoken to people about the bench, and lots of people have said, oh, we like to see the bench, we like to read it, and see what it says. So I suppose that's part of it that I haven't said to you about what's on the plaque.
Well, you mentioned the four images, but yeah, not the text.
Not the text, yeah, because part of the text is the desiderata, which is something that he was very, very fond of. And then the piece just afterwards then is a piece from Marcus Aurelius, which is what he was reading. He'd started to read it in 2014, and he was reading more of it. And basically the part that's there is the bit about seize the day, mm-hmm. you know, live every day as if it's your last, which was what he did. It's what he felt, definitely,
mm-hmm.
and certainly later, when he was reading more, and he couldn't do much else. And then the bottom bit is Paul Simon, still crazy after all these years.
Mm-hmm.
And but you know, he had three lots of chemotherapy. They were doing it just really sort of thing to try and keep the pain away as much as anything. So he lived for 7 weeks.
Mm.
So, you know, it was like we had extra time, which was good because we had time to think about what we wanted to do, mm. what he wanted to do, you know, how he wanted to go.
Yeah.
Oh, dear. When the people that used to live next door to us had a humanist mm-hmm. Ceremony for the dad, and the guy that did it was lovely, it was really, really nice. And ages before, Thomas said to me, so if anything happens, he said, I want Alan Penny to mm-hmm. do his humanist together. Anyway, when he was in hospital, and he was talking to the kids, and he said he wanted this guy, and he said to both of them, you know, he's a decent chap, he's got proper shoes. And Tom was very, very puff about shoes, mm-hmm. really, oh God. Anyway, so when eventually it came, so when we were sorting out for him to be cremated, we went down to the place that we've always gone since like my dad passed away and all the rest of it, and Tom had sorted out what he wanted to wear, and I said to the guy what he wanted to wear, and he said, no shoes. I said, oh, right, no shoes. I said, he wanted to be buried with his shoes on. He said, no, he said, can't put shoes on. He said, can't. So anyway, what we did, the shoes that he always wore was churches. And when you get churches shoes, because like they're sort of like £500-600 a
pair. Wow.
You get a bag for each shoe.
Did you put the bags on his feet? That's brilliant.
So you went into the tunnel. We couldn't send it. I mean, he wanted his shoes, so we had to send him with the bags because that was the only thing that we'd be able to go. But they'd got churches on. So he went.
What,
I didn't go.
What would he think to that?
I think he would have thought, well, if I can't bloody well have my shoes, at least I've got the bags.
Yeah. Do you think he'd find it funny?
I think he'd find it hilarious. I think he would have thoroughly approved of it. Yeah, because he wanted his jeans on. And then the undertaker said, have you got a denim jacket? And Matthew just went, you don't wear double denim. Can you imagine double denim and shoe bags?
Yeah.
What would they have made of him when he got there?
Isn't it amazing how something as traumatic and sad as what's happened can actually result in light-hearted, funny story that will go down in your family history now forever.
Yeah, it is, you know, it is, you know, I don't know anybody else that's been so fussy about the shoes and had to have, you know, go with them as well, so shoe bags.
I think this feels like a good place to stop while this laughter, if that's all right with you.
No, that's fine.
Okay, I'll stop the recording.
No.